Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is May 7th, 2017, and this is the fourth Sunday of Easter.
My Shepherd is based on the 23rd Psalm. It was written by Henry Baker, whose father was one of the admirals in the British Navy, but he was an Anglican minister. Henry W. Baker, one of the outstanding hymns of the Anglican Church, written by Henry Baker, an Anglican minister. He lived 1821-1877. It's an Irish tune.
Thank you. the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Yeah. second reading is from 1 Peter. It is a credit to you if, being aware of God, you endure pain while suffering unjustly. If you endure when you are beaten for doing wrong, what credit is that? But if you endure when you do right and suffer for it, you have God's approval. For to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving an example, so that you should follow in his steps. He committed no sin, and no deceit was found in his mouth. When he was abused, he did not return abuse. When he suffered, he did not threaten. But he entrusted himself to the one who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, so that free from sins we might live for righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed, for you were going astray like sheep, but now you have returned to the shepherd and guardian of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For the gospel, our pastor is Pastor John Pollock. We'll be reading the scripture. This is May the 7th, Good Shepherd Sunday.
The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep hear his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes ahead of them, and the sheep follow him because they know his voice. They will not follow a stranger, but they will run from him because they do not know the voice of strangers. Jesus used this figure of speech with them, but they did not understand what he was saying to them. So again Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me are thieves and bandits, but the sheep did not listen to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters by me will be saved and will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord.
A couple of announcements quickly. First of all, thanks to everyone who helped with the garage sale, everyone who donated items for it, everyone who purchased items from it. Once again, we had a successful couple of days of garage sale, and thanks to everyone for whatever part you took to do it. It's greatly appreciated. Also, a reminder, as I have been mentioning, especially now since this is the first Sunday in May, 3 weeks from now, the 8 o'clock service will be opening out of the drive-in for our summer, 62nd Street summer drive-in worship experience. So, May 28th, hopefully by then it'll be warm. May 28th, we'll have that first drive-in service celebrating Memorial Day weekend. Now,
thank you.
today. You notice that after missing last week, you have some this week, and I'm sure you can also tell I did because I'm not sure late. Why that's so unprofessional to me. But don't worry. It's a good thing to follow up. Looking at the 10th chapter of the Gospel of John and the theme of Abundant Life. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. A middle-aged housewife made the following comments. I always thought by the time my husband had his own business, we had paid off the mortgage on the house, and the kids were old enough to look after themselves, that I would be home free. I thought that there'd be no more problems, but it hasn't worked out that way. I worked hard, and I got most of the things I wanted, but they don't seem to mean what I thought they would. I'm getting bored with my life. I even began to envy those women who had high Christian careers. Oh, I have a nice house, but I've spent 25 years in it, bringing up two kids, and I'm fed up with it. I'd like to move back into an apartment, like my husband and I had when we were first married. These days, the two of us seem to spend half of our time arguing about what went wrong. We feel as though we wasted a lot of time. But I don't think either of us really knows what we want now, except that it is something else besides what we have. Sound familiar? It could be called the modern-day American woman. How many people have a life just like this middle-aged woman, where they thought that if they chased the goals that society told them to chase, that if they chased after all that the advertisers told them they should have, if they chased all those things their peers told them they needed in order to be successful, how many today thought they would live an abundant life by doing that? Find themselves instead wondering where their life went and how did it end up being like it is now. So we contrast that great American lament over chasing the material and the physical. And we compare that with the words of our Lord Jesus Christ in the 10th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John. Where in that 10th verse he says, quote, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I came that they may have life and have it abundantly." The word translated as thief literally means to steal by fraud or in secret. But as Jesus is speaking to us this morning, the thief does not have to be an individual who's actually taking something from us, a possession or whatever. The thief can be anything, anyone, that tries to take us away from our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Anyone who tries to lead us away from true abundant life in Christ, through faith in Christ, to follow something. The thief can be a false ideology, such as communism or materialism. It can be a false idea, such as fame will make you happy, or power will make you happy. The thief can be debauchery, or a life based on carnal desires, addictions, or any other thought or action that takes us away from the will of God. The word translated as kill, then, means to slaughter, to kill for a sacrifice. The thieves of the world would steer us away from the Good Shepherd to do so that we might be slaughtered or killed as a sacrifice to that which is ungodly or anti-God. Then the word destroy, another attribute of those things, means to cause to perish, to destroy fully or completely. It means to destroy something in such a way that one brick is not left upon another. It means to destroy so that there is no trace of anything left. The devil uses the enticements and desires of the world, as well as the pain and suffering of the world, in order to pull us away from Jesus Christ, so that we would be destroyed or perish along with Satan on the day that he returns. Satan knows how the story ends. Satan knows what he has in store. And so he wants to drag as many of us with him as he can. His motivation is the idea that if he drags enough of us with him, then God surely would condemn that many people, and so he can get away with it. But that's not what Scripture tells us. It tells us that when Jesus comes again, he will separate the sheep from the goats. He will separate those who believe in him from those who turn their back on him. And so we must not be fooled by the devil's enticement. We must not be fooled when the devil comes to us, as he did to our first parents, with that question, did God really say? Or, more likely in our case, did Jesus really say? Trying to sow that bit of doubt in our minds so that we will not trust the promise Jesus has made us. But then, along comes the good news we proclaim, in which Jesus says, I came that they may have life and have it abundantly. It is amazing, and in reality it is sorrowful, that so many people today have the wrong picture of Jesus Christ. That you have people today who think of Jesus Christ only as a judge returning in vengeance. That they see Jesus only as the Jesus of the last day who will separate those sheep and goats and who will make those judgments. But that's the Jesus of his second coming. That's not the Jesus of man. That's not the Jesus that God sent into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. That is not the Jesus who laid down his life for the sheep, so that the sheep might have abundant life. But there are so many people out there today who don't see Jesus that way. They think he's just this strict moralist, or he's this strict party pooper. That he's someone who wants to take away fun and joy out of life, when it is the exact opposite. He came to give life meaning, even in the midst of tragedy. There's a saying by a Christian theologian that I find really helpful. He says, quote, Jesus didn't come into the world to do away with suffering. He didn't come into the world to explain it away. He came to fill it with his presence. That is the Jesus of man. The Jesus who comes to us and fills us with his presence in the good times and in the bad times. Who comes to us and fills us with his presence so that we may have abundant life. The word abundantly means to the full, to be more than enough, to be exceedingly great. Jesus is promising us that following him, he will give us life that is more than enough, that is full, that exceeds life of those who chase the goals only of society. What makes this promise important is that Jesus Christ seals this promise with his blood upon the cross. He is the one who was slaughtered or killed as a sacrifice for sin, so that all the world might be redeemed. And again, that is a portrait of Jesus that is sometimes forgotten. That Jesus died so that the entire world might be redeemed. Not just the Jews, not just the Greeks, not just the Romans, but every person of every tribe, every nation, every race, every creed, every color, every ethnic group. That is why today the Great Commission is as ever important as it was the day Jesus gave it. That we go out into all the world, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to observe all that he has commanded us, and that lo, he is with us always until the end of the age. He is a redeemer of the whole world. He is a redeemer for each and every person, and he brings them abundant life. Through faith in him, we have salvation and eternal life, not because of what we have done, but because he has done it all. He has done it all and gives to us that gift of faith and salvation. The abundant life you discover is not chasing after the trinkets of the world that in the end have no value whatsoever, but instead, the abundant life is a life of serving Jesus Christ and God's creation. A life of serving our Lord Jesus Christ and serving his church. A life of serving the Lord Jesus Christ, his church, and entering into the fields of harvest that are waiting for someone to come and harvest it. Remember, Jesus told us the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. We are those laborers on whom Jesus is depending. He is depending on each one of us so that when we answer his call, we will discover that serving him is a very satisfying experience. That serving him is more satisfying than earthly treasure or any earthly prize we might win along life's journey. When I was a freshman in high school, we were living in Lexington, Kentucky. His dad was finishing his doctorate degree in education to become a college professor. And I was attending Morton Junior High School, and the Optimist Club of Lexington had this practice of going to each junior high school and presenting a silver bowl to the person they designate as the student of the year. Each freshman class had one student so designated. Well, in my freshman class, 1960-something, I was the winner of that award. I had this nice, shiny silver bowl. And somewhere, as I told him this morning at 8 o'clock, somewhere Gina found a picture that my parents had taken of me holding that silver bowl in my suit, and I said, if there had been a casting call for Ichabod Crane for me, I would have been the winner. If you would see that picture of me as a freshman, you never believe that it's me. Because I turned sideways and I disappeared. But anyhow, you know, I won that thing. That night was a big deal. And I thought, wow, I'm really on the road to something here. I'm the student of the year of my junior high school. Well, as the years passed by, I forgot all about it. My parents kept the bowl. And I think my mother put sewing thread and needles in it or something. But when they went to move, they found that it was all tarnished and all this. They gave it to Gina and said, you might like this. And I have no idea where in the house it is today. And if you go back to Martin Junior High School, nobody would have a clue who I was and that I wanted. So that's the way it is on earth. That's the way it is with earthly treasure. They're big for the moment, but then they disappear. The glory is gone. 200 in my graduating class, and it was only 300 in 1999. But too often, we are fooled into believing that abundant living is like Our Lady in the opening story, who thought obtaining all her earthly goals would give her a happy life. But sadly, she's facing the twilight years of her life very unsatisfied. She doesn't know what she wants. She just knows she doesn't want what she has now. This is why Jesus Christ spent so much time preaching and teaching about not storing up treasures on earth, but instead storing up treasures in heaven. Because the treasures of earth fade, and they decay, and they're destroyed, and they're stolen, and they're misplaced. But those treasures in heaven are never taken away and can never disappear. He knew that if we based our life on things of this world, we would come to the twilight of our lives very unsatisfied and feeling as if we hadn't lived life, but instead wasted opportunity after opportunity. There's an old story told about Julius Caesar before he became emperor, or before he was assassinated and had a chance to become really emperor. He was out on a military campaign, and there was a pause in the fighting, and the members of the legion were sharpening their weapons, and Caesar was meeting with his generals to make battle plans. And after the meeting was over, the legionnaire came to Caesar with a request, and their request was that the man wanted Caesar to give him permission to commit suicide. The legionnaire that approached him was wretched, dispirited, and had no vitality whatsoever. Caesar looked at him and said, "Man, were you ever alive?" That is the way life often ends up for those who base abundant living on the things of the world instead of on Jesus Christ. When we base our lives on the things of the world, we end up disappointed. But when we base our life on Jesus Christ, we have that abundant living. Without faith in our Lord Jesus Christ, we never truly live. We may go through life and experience it. We may experience all kinds of experiences, but when it's all said and done, we haven't really lived. We may think we have done the best we can, but without Jesus Christ, our efforts are useless. Jesus Christ promises us that if we enter life through Him, that's what He's talking about when He's talking about entering through the gate of the sheep, that He's that gate. If we enter life by Him, then He says in verse 9, quote, "We'll be saved and we'll go in and out and find pasture." That word "saved" means to be kept safe, to be preserved, to be delivered. It means salvation. Salvation from sin, death, and the power of the devil. Jesus Christ is the door. Jesus Christ is the door to forgiveness. Jesus Christ is the door to victory over sin, death, and the devil. Jesus Christ is the door to eternal life. In our gospel lesson next week, we will hear Jesus say, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." Jesus being that door, He gives us security. The security of going out into life and looking to serve Christ by serving others without faith. In Christ we find pasture that is life worth living each and every day. A father once took his small son to visit a huge cathedral. As the two were walking down the aisle, the young boy looked up at the altar in the middle of the altar, and he asked his dad, and he said, "Father, what is that big plus sign up there?" If we ever think our Christian faith subtracts something from our lives, we are grievously mistaken. For the Christian faith does not take any away from life. The Christian faith is a big plus sign that adds the best there is to our lives. Adding to our lives so that we may indeed have life and have it abundantly. Amen. Peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Time for our offering. Janet Hogue and Helen Wallace are the ushers today. This is the 7th of May, the 4th Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. This is Good Shepherd Sunday. Many of the themes today have been on 23rd Psalm. in Jesus' gospel, the gospel that he is the good shepherd, he is the gate, he allows us to enter, he doesn't keep us out. He has the abundant life ready for us, and he is here with us. We have received absolution, forgiveness of our sins, and we are prepared now to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. We believe in the real presence of Jesus in the body and the blood. This is the appearance of the bread and the appearance of the wine. However, we know that Jesus is present here just as he said. We can trust what he says. I am the bread of life, and the bread is given for us. Jesus is really present with us, down to the molecules, down to the atoms, down to the energy, everything. His full body and blood and spirit is with us, and we will receive him today. He'll become a part of us, we'll become a part of him, and we receive eternal life. We're thankful for that. Christ is risen. He's risen indeed. This is the fourth Sunday of Easter, Good Shepherd Sunday.
my body given for you. Do this
for the remembrance of me.
Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant, not my blood shed for you, for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering therefore his sacrificial command, his life giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we, and all who share in the body and blood of Christ, may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people, and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church now and forever.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you. body and blood may abide in him and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us, hymn number 789 in the back of your worship. Hymn number 789.
This hymn was written by Dorothy A. Thrupp. It was originally written for children. She wrote children's hymns. The music is written by William Bradbury, a very famous hymn tune writer who began the era of gospel music. He also wrote the music for Just As I Am, Jesus Loves Me, Sweet Hour of Prayer, He Needs Me, many very famous hymns. Savior Like a Shepherd Lead Us. Music by William Bradbury, words by Dorothy Thrupp. Service on YouTube, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. This is the 7th of May, the 4th Sunday of Easter. Christ is risen, He is risen indeed. We received His precious blood and His body, and He is within us. This is the most holy time that we have. As we have been forgiven of our sins and have obtained the forgiveness of sins, absolution, and we've taken Holy Communion. Jesus Christ died for us, and He is present with us right now. We receive eternal life, and we've taken communion to help with the spreading of the gospel. Jesus is with us. He's risen. He's risen indeed. The flowers on the chancel stands are to the glory of God and presented by Nelson and Linda Smith in honor of spring. It's a cold day today, but spring is on the way. Pastor and Gina have given flowers in honor of grandchildren Katie and Ben Pollock's May birthdays. The honor of grandchildren and also Katie and Ben Pollock's May birthday. We're thankful for Holy Communion today. We're thankful that we are able to be led like a shepherd. This is Good Shepherd Sunday, and our theme has been on the 23rd Psalm. Jesus is the gate. He's our good shepherd. He's the gate to let us in, not to keep us out. We're all open here for him. We had Becky Dimitroff, Linda Smith, Sally Baker, Janet Hogue, and Helen Wallace assisting today. We invite you to come worship with us. 8 o'clock, the service will be moved to the Melody Cruise-In Drive-In on Memorial Day. That'll be the first Sunday, and through Labor Day, we'll meet at the Melody Cruise-In at 8 o'clock, rain or shine. Come in your car. And then the 10:30 service will be here, and it'll be the one to be broadcast on YouTube most of the Sundays. We're honored to have your presence. We pray for you, ask you to pray for us and our YouTube ministry. We invite you to come worship with us. If you can, we make you welcome. And we invite you to receive communion, to encounter the living Christ. We've had our encounter with the living Christ through the Word, through our fellowship with one another, and through the Holy Communion, where we receive the real body and blood, the real presence of Jesus Christ, who nourishes us, who sustains us, as he has said, I am the bread of life. Thank you for worshiping with us. God bless you. We'll pray for you. We'll pray for our YouTube ministry.